His work has earned him numerous prestigious awards, including the Best Innovation 2022 at the 11th International Petrochemical Awards from the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas, Government of India, and the Best Teacher Award 2022 at IIT BHU. Other accolades include the Outstanding PhD Dissertation Award from Florida International University, the IIT Gold Medal from IIT BHU, the McCarey Award from American Ceramic Society, and MRS Poster Award from the Material Research Society, USA. Dr. Das is a Fellow for Indian Institute of Ceramics 2024, the Indian Chemical Society 2022, and the Royal Society of Chemistry at 2021. He became a senior member of IEEE in 2017. Recognizing his significant research contributions over the past decade, he has published over 140 peer-reviewed high-impact research articles, authored one book, contributed to 6 book chapters, and holds 12 patents, including 2 granted in the US and 8 in India. His research has garnered more than 4,400 citations with an H-index of 37 and I-10 index of 90. In addition to his academic achievements, Dr. Das has successfully transferred several technologies from the laboratory to startup industrial scales, contributing to the development of indigenous products in India. He remains actively involved in national and international scientific communities, serving in editorial boards, award committees, and as a member of various scientific societies. Welcome you, sir.
Okay, so thank you so much. It's been a nice introduction. So can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
I'm just trying to talk to the audience. I don't know how many are still awake and how many just sleeping after post lunch. So anyway, so can you see my screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So if you see the screen, so and my voice is clear probably, right? So first of all, I would like to thanks to Dr. Devarajan and the organizing committee to invite me on this podium. And so this is really an honor to give a FDP lecture on this atomic scale hybrid nanostructure, a new archetype to electronics and energy devices. So if you guys can see my screen, can you see the screen? All. So is there people are interested to interact? So yeah, so if you guys are on, this is good. If no, is there anyone who can
Sir, visible, sir. It's visible.
No, not visible. I'm saying that is there any person who can interact? So like it's just, I'm just telling this fact and then people are listening or not, I don't know. So that's what I always prefer to be an interactive session. My voice is clear, sir. Right?
Yes, sir, your voice is very clear.
So if you kindly been interactive, it will be great. So thank you so much. So here I am from the Indian Institute of Technology, BHU Varanasi. So in my campus is almost 13 acre complete area. And I am here in Ceramic Engineering Department where we are celebrating centenary this year. So we are in 100 years old department and we are celebrating 2024 is the 100th years of the department. So it's an old heritage, it's my research group. Most of them are very active member except me, the most inactive. And the rest of the people are working really very hard and that's what we are. We are being developing several new concepts in science and technology that I'm going to discuss over here. So basically, I'll start discussing with the world of two-dimensional materials and followed by the different kind of heterostructured material, van der Waals, super lattices, CVD-grown and VPT-grown different large area 2D MOS2, typically nanoscale engineering of graphene and high frequency microwave absorption and different kind of atomic scale engineering of 2D material for optoelectronics. We also have a different special notes on different kind of ACRS type of molecular detection kind of things, along with a different kind of nanoscale engineering of 2D, 1D hybrid materials for hydrogen generation and water splitting. Finally, I will go through the summary and future prospect of this field And that's what, so let's start. How to start, since so what is materials engineer's guide to galaxy, like how materials engineers would build up their world. So typically what we do basically surface engineering, various kind of nanoscale engineering, interfacial engineering, defect engineering, functionalization, building up nano archetypes, and so many things. So how this nanosurface and macro surface has been observed. So we look at this guy, the CERT. So they do have, do you know what kind of thing is this? Anybody interested to interact? What is this? Can you see my scar, sir?
Whale, is it whale, sir?
What is this?
Can is you it see a whale, the
cursor? Sir? Is it whale or shark?
Shark.
Shark. So this is a shark. And what is this? It's a lotus leaf. And this is a butterfly.
Lotus leaf.
Yeah. And this is a butterfly. Or you can say it's as a dragonfly. So now if you look at this... look at this structure. So whatever their macro surfaces look like, basically their micro or nano surface is different. Now if you look at this structure, this is basically typical shark skin. What is the benefit of having shark skin? Have you have any idea? So basically what is there in the lotus leaf, and specifically at the nano scale, such that the surface is basically look like a hydrophobic surface. Also, if you look at a butterfly, so that dragonfly has a very interesting surface structure. You see a whitish patch, blackish region, transparent region, so many regions are basically, so are they really transparent or are they really black? Basically, they're made out of a similar structure that's called feather or cellulose type of things. And that basically orientates in a different direction, and that's why the color evolves. So the goal of this slide is just to let you convey a message like macro surface is something that we see. However, the nano or micro surface is something which is absolutely different compared to the macro surface. So if we move further, so what are the future nanotechnology? Sorry about that. So future nanotechnology basically are focusing towards self-assembly or self-driven car. Have you heard about this self-driven car? Is anyone have any idea or what is the meaning of self-driven car? Have you have any idea what is self-driven car basically? So if you don't have any
autopilot.
Idea, pardon?
Autopilot.
Autopilot. So you are correct. So driver, if it is automatically, car is driven and you just put this map like where you want to go and you just sit there in this driver's seat, and then car will take you there, means auto intelligent car actually. So what is that problem of this car? So there might be have a high possibility of strike, you know. So each other will strike to each other very strongly. Question is there anything that we can develop that they will not generate any strike or any accident during self-driven time? So that's what this mother nature, that this mother nature, so if you see the evening, this flock of birds is basically moving around the sky. So both all these birds moving so smoothly. Have you ever seen this? Do they get stuck to each other and fall down? Never. That's the reason they also create such beautiful pattern. And that's what this all invention, mother nature is the most important. Now we look at this, a flock of fish. So those flock of fish, they're basically having moving very fastly inside a sea or a river. So this flock of fish basically getting their food even from dizzy or muddy water. So what is the idea? Like that's the reason they have some sort of sensor underneath of their mouth, and that's kind of sensor, and that movement is called stochastic movement. So that's what this kind of paper is coming, that how stochastic resonance in response to photodetector can be developed, and how bird-inspired self-navigation in artificial synaptic compasses. So those kind of concept is still generating. Now, in a world of two-dimensional material, we know a lot of materials which are having no z direction or z direction. So the x and y direction materials are basically known as 2D material. And the father of everyone basically started with this guy graphene. So when a single layer, monoatomic layer, is been taken out from a graphite stack, and that's basically formed graphene. And that graphene basically having H and following graphene, HBN, hexagonal boron nitride, metal oxide framework, and then magazines, LDH, oxides, metals, so many different things have been developed, followed by, along with the TMDs, transition metal disulfonates. So here, my job is today to show some of a unique feature of this graphene and 2D transition metal disulfonates. And this field is typically a solid, pure interdisciplinary field of research, which is basically need a concept of physics, chemistry, chemical engineering, fluid dynamics, material science, thermodynamics, and so on. Question is, what is heterostructured material? So if heterostructured materials can be defined, when different layered materials have been stacked to each other and then form a simplest form of 3D structure is basically known as heterostructure, because these materials are having different properties while their interface is basically hetero interface, not similar interface. That's what they are known as heterostructure materials. How many types of heterostructures are available in this world? So typically, when 2D materials are vertically, stacked, so this is a vertically stacked heterostructure. When 2D material are joined horizontally, this is called horizontal stack. When 2D, 1D nanowire, nanoribbons is connected with one to each other. So that's basically connected to 2D material itself, and then 2D, 3D structure. So many new things, and also 2D, 0D quantum dots. All these structures, they have either shape anisotropy or the size anisotropy or the structural anisotropy. So that's what, when they stack or join to each other, basically form a heterostructure. Lots of different types of techniques are there, solution process, 2D materials. Basically, they are all slowly prototyping. Different kind of prototyping techniques are there, like drop casting, vacuum filtration, and followed by different kind of high throughput, like 3D printing, spray coating, ink jetting, and so many different applications are also been developed. So here, our goal is to discuss typically molysulfide type of things. So molysulfide is semiconductor materials having band gap 1.8 electron volt, having three different structure. One is called 2H structure, which is semiconductor in nature, is called trigonal prismatic. And then one is octahedral structure, is called 1T structure, which is metallic in nature. And then 3R structure, which is called trigonal prismatic, which is again another semiconductor structure. So these transition and structure are so interesting that we can develop a lot of different type of heterostructure, different type of molecular junction, interface, so many things. So here in this one of the review, we saw that there is a lot of possibilities of working with different kind of heterostructures. So our first goal and first understanding will start with a different kind of nanoscale engineering. So first and foremost is nanoscale engineering in graphene for high frequency microwave absorber. Question is, what do you mean by steel technology or radar absorbing material? Do you know what is steel technology? Is there anybody who can interact? So what do you mean by steel technology or radar absorbing material?
You cannot see the aeroplane on radar by using stealth technology.
You are hiding your own flight such that you can go and somewhere get the information or strike to some other region, correct?
Correct.
So that's
no
what
radar signature will come.
Yeah. So that's what this tail technology, where they're used to basically. So basically they used for in various type of stealth fighter B-2 bomber. Different kind of conventional aircraft can easily been detected, but due to the different size is not detected easily. So with these different kind of Russian stealth submarine, this is one of the example. And then also recently India has developed a lot of different kind of unmanned aircraft demonstration flight, drone, specifically and different military or war movie, you can see different kind of drones in being used. Those all are basically generated with a different kind of stealth technology. These stealth technology are typically very interesting to know. So question is how to disguise. So you see the movie Uri. If you see the movie Uri, so that kind of drone basically sent to get the information. So question is, what kind of nanocomposite coating has been used such that we can get a simply the radar absorbing material? So typically we use a big plate and we coat with some kind of different kind of composite material. This kind of powder material has been spray coated on this powder, and then the sample is basically kept here, and then using a vector network analyzer, we send some signal. And we receive some signal and we see how much is basically coming back. If there is any event, basically they completely come back. So that means they are basically not using as a radar absorbing. So that material, which is basically in sample, supposed to absorb the entire frequency such that nothing is come back. Otherwise, that's a big problem. So what kind of material has been used here? So typically we used graphene, and then graphene oxide and also reduced graphene oxide. And then that was basically we used some spray painting, hand brushing, and using a nanocomposite coating. We mix it with a polyurethane. And then this sprayable composite, we basically coat it on a surface. And that defect reconstruction also, we create inside the defect in that material, and that basically produces different kind of point defect, line defect, interlayer. So is there any idea what do you mean by defect? Like, is there anybody who can say what do you mean by defect?
Maybe missing atoms or one or two atoms present in between the atoms.
Okay, so that means you are trying to say that there is a missing atoms or missing what? Missing atoms or missing?
Several types of defects, sir.
Several types of defect, line defect, point defect. Actually, defect means something is not there which is supposed to be there. So imagine these all atoms are properly placed. So that means there is no defect. But if one atom is missing, that's basically a defect. Or if there is any other atom is present here, that's also a defect.
Yes, sir.
So it's supposed not to be there. So something which is supposed not to be, but if those things are present, so then it's called defect, right? So right. That's why defect has a long meaning. Typically, point defect, we're talking about the missing atom. Hello. So there is a lot of point defects and line defects and different kind of functionalization defect. So these basically create a different kind of cole semicircles inside the graphene that causes the dielectric relaxation process. And that basically produces the insufficient induced charges and that incomplete lattice structure in reduced graphene oxide. So what we did basically, so we take a graphene oxide, which is very crystalline in nature, and then we reduce it in different form. So our reduction form is different time and solution based, and then we basically found that the structure is typically okay. However, there are a lot of defects because this crumpling structure clearly shows the defect. So these kind of defects are basically shown here. If you see the IR there is some noise coming. Can you please check? Hello.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, some voice coming? Can you please check from where this voice?
Excuse me, participants, kindly turn off your mute your audio, please. Then you can listen. Audience kindly requested to mute your audio.
Yeah, no. Those people are interacting with me. That's so nice of them. So I like that people interact and that I want actually to be interacted. That's okay, why it's good that they're turning on their mic. But please also, if there is an unusual noise, please try to turn off. Otherwise, it's a big problem. So let's move on. So if you see that X-ray diffraction, so graphene oxide, basically when reduced to RGO, they basically shifted to a certain position, is basically called reduced graphene oxide. And Raman spectroscopy also shows different Ig by Id ratio. This Id means intensity of D band and intensity of G band. If ratio is very high, then typically it's an impart the electronic conductivity or something like that, or crystallinity. So that's what this means, Id by Ig. Well, in FTR, if you see, there is a lot of bond vibration present, a lot of different kind of bonds, CC bond, COH bond, CO bond, COH bond, so many bonds are there. But after it's reducing with a different time for 5 seconds, 10 seconds, 20 seconds. So then your bonding which changes. So different kind of functional group basically reduces. And there is a sharp difference, COH bond is completely gone. And then what we did, we do a spray coating. And that spray coating is measured, and we find out the S11 parameter. With that S11 parameter, we calculate the ZS, impedance of that material. And we can clearly see, if we plot the absorptivity versus frequency with a certain band, like here it is plotted from 2 to 15 gigahertz. Now, if you look at very carefully, from almost 5 to 12, like in K band, this green one shows the complete absorption compared to any other. So this complete absorption, this green one is G20. The G20 is this one. So this G20 basically shows the complete absorption at this point. That means the absorptivity is almost near to 100%, means if that signal has been sent to that material, any kind of frequency or other signal has been sent to this material, basically what it's reflected back is in the receiving antenna is basically not receiving any signal. That means the material is completely in disguise. So what we do, basically, we also develop different kind of hybrid structure, hybrid framework, different kind of coating, and those coating we basically analyzed over scanning electron microscope. It clearly shows a layer is basically the graphite layer, graphene layer is basically impregnate with a complete small nanoparticles. So those small nanoparticles are basically ferrite nanostructures. So those ferrite nanostructures basically created this kind of things where we clearly see the graphene and NZF nanoparticle. So that's basically forming different kind of layer interfaces, and that interfaces causes the magnetodielectric interfaces. That interface basically absorbing the frequency. So in another work, what we do, we basically use the same measurement, but we have a different forms of technique. So here we take the material. So that material is basically a graphene oxide with a different reduction part. So the different reduction like 3-3, 5-0, and 6-6, we can clearly see that 6-6, GO-6-6 one is a very, very good one. So with this, we clearly measure this transmitting antenna. And there, that basically gives us an idea like how we develop things. And then this kind of paper was submitted in somehow published in Nature Scientific Report in 2019. And it was always this top 100 in material science collection. We have a lot of appreciation on this. So what is the take-home message out of this kind of work? So take-home message is basically Kolekole Semikar circle. They basically form the dielectric relaxation process under the alternating electromagnetic field. Reconstructed carbon framework typically form this RGO lattice, which causes the lack of charge induction in RGO structure. Defect-induced polarization center generates polarization relaxation. Alternating electromagnetic field causes different kind of microwave loss. And this way, typically, we had this. So just hold on. My laptop is out of charge. Just hold on. I put the charger. Yes. So can you see the slide?
It says visible.
So this is in its first part. So these residual oxygen containing chemical bonds that create this localized arrest of electron. And also what we realize, like magneto-dielectric interfaces causes the primary absorption of the microwave. So this is one of the segment of this presentation. And the second one is basically atomic scale two-dimensional materials for optoelectronic and quantum devices for different kind of molecular detection. So what we did here, we have a different configuration of the transistors, different kind of. So do you know what is transistor is? Is there anybody who can tell us what is transistor is?
It is a one kind of PN junction diode. It has three terminal.
It is not PN junction, sir. It is kind of a junction device, definitely. But here, what we do, we basically channelize the electron flow. So with a bias, we channelize the electron flow, and the other way around, we restrict the electron flow. So that's what. It basically can form 0101, means when electron flow is current flow, that is 1. When no flow, it is called 0. 0101 means that kind of with an applied electric field, they can create a logic. And that's what transistor device basically used most of in our mobile and computers, having different kind of logic. And that's what this logic device has been developed for last several years, several decades. So what we do basically here, we use chemical vapor deposition synthesis. We use different kind of synthesis technique. We deposit molysulfide on a surface, and this exactly look like this, the triangular structure. Our goal is also developed a different kind of large area 2D MOS2, and this large area 2D MOS2 is basically form until also half a millimeter size. You see there is 500 micron scale one. So that is sometimes, you know, half a millimeter size of a large area moly flake. And that large area moly flake can be controlled with a monolayer flake, and that can be used for different kind of transistor manufacturing. And we also source the large area demonstration for 1000 micron scale, where you see the almost a large area, more millimeter by millimeter. And each and every flake, we identify this from different point-wise. You see the Raman spectroscopy, if we can plot it, it shows a completely uniform monolayer two-dimensional molysulfide. And this mapping also showing some sort of So, we also deposit different kind of other things like we also use RFDC sputtering unit, CVD unit, chemical vapor deposition unit, and we also deposit different kind of thin films, and that thin films also sulfurized to MOS2, and that sulfurization MOS2 is basically used for different kind of device making, like, you know, we make different kind of micro scale and nanoscale devices, and those micro scale nanoscale devices can completely develop in this manner. And this kind of things use as a MOS capacitor devices. So what does this capacitor do? Basically, if we change the different current here, the dose of current increases from 100 to 500, you clearly see the response of capacitance changes. So that basically a kind of photosensor that we have used, so MOS capacitor based photosensor that we developed. And then next part, what we develop, we also developed metal semiconductor, metal prototype. So here we typically form a different material, and then we also generate MOS2 on a large area device. Also, we can make different type of small electrode, and that electrode can even develop in throughout the substrate. And then we see even we can do the wafer scale 2D MOS2 for flexible silicon devices. We can also manufacture, and that metal based prototypes basically used for different kind of photosensing. So with a forward bias and reverse bias, you can also see the equivalent current change along with a different dose of light intensity. So this successfully formation of photodiodes, then we also developed a different class of vertical junctions. So here we developed a different kind of vertical junction, P silicon and N MOS2. Vertical junction devices, and that vertical junction device kind of formation. So this manuscript is still under submission. Here we will submit it soon. And our data shows that time dependent current value is basically light on and light off. It shows a different dose of changing of light, the current density changes. And also in this regard, we also developed a new paradigm of sensing, where actually we also developed 2D nano network. So different kind of silver metallic nano network can be formed, and using that nano network, we typically demonstrated different kind of sensors. So this sensor is basically AGTI, AG4, TI5, O12 film, and surface enhanced thermal spectroscopy. There we show that clearly this nano network on this substrate basically form this kind of isolation. And this isolation of the structure basically itself help as an enhancement of different kind of molecular detection. So here we develop different kind of molecular detection using this structure. So summary and perspective here, we must say 2D MOS2 could be the ideal replacement of graphene. And their electronic, optoelectronic, and quantum devices can also lead to a change. And definitely, this kind of growing large-scale material are very, very challenging and also need it in Indian perspective. So quantum mission, government, whatever they're proposing. So this 2D material is very highly promising. Sometimes with a very high in-plane conductivity, have a challenging to integrate with the existing substrate. So that's the most challenge, number two. So existing substrate, whatever it is, you need to develop those kind of material on a substrate. So this large area deposition is extremely important to scale up the technique. Developing MOS to thin layer, 8 to 10 nanometer is very important. So that's why different possibilities are also evolving with an enormous possibility to develop light detecting devices. And that is 2D, 3D architecture at junction. Also need to know some sort of knowledge development that we are basically working for. And then we are generating some sort of hybrid architecture structure, which basically goes for different kind of water splitting. So do you know what do you mean by water splitting? Hello. Is there anybody?
Sir, what is your question? Yes.
Okay. So my question is, now in a third section, I'm going to show you nanoscale engineering of different type of hybrid materials for hydrogen generation via water splitting. So question is, do you know what is water splitting?
Through electrolysis, we can split up H plus OH after that to generating hydrogen productions.
That's true. Interesting. Yeah, that's true. Interesting. And let's start discussing with this. So electrolysis sensors. So what is the concern? Why this kind of things need to be worked on, evaluated? Do you know this? Why this kind of things? It's basically energy crisis. And not only energy crisis, on the earth, we have really having green energy crisis, because most of the energy generated on the earth surface is basically producing carbon dioxide, which basically polluting the environment. So the question is it possible to replace the entire carbon footprint with a green hydrogen type of things? So this green fuel or green hydrogen nowadays are taking a very big leap. So what is their status? So typically four countries: China, European Union, India, and US. So these four countries are major contributor to the world. So that's a typical contribution is basically make a roadmap, like what they are basically going to change this way. So it shows that India give a target like share of renewable energy to 75% by 2050, which was 9% in 2015. So there is a big, big achievement. And also share of renewable energy in power section or power devices, 15% was 2015, like 9 years ago. And within 2050, India is going to replace 92%. So India is basically going to become a big, big global leader for hydrogen evolution. So typically this socioeconomic footprint from given combination of energy transport roadmap is there. Our Prime Minister basically on 13th November 2021, from 31st October to 13th November in Glasgow, in the United Nations Climate Change Conference, basically he gave Panchamrit. So this 5 point, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, basically gives achieving net zero by India by 2070. By that time, obviously, so all of we are not certain that we all will live there, but why not to work such a way that it will be reached by 2070? And the another most challenging part is increasing non-fossil energy capacity, means coal-based things to be transformed into, to reach 500 gigawatt by 2030. The question, how does this work? Why it will happen? So typically, hydrogen evaluation reaction is basically known as HER, H-E-R. Question is, fundamental of HER is fundamental of hydrogen generation reaction via water splitting. How does this occur? Basically, it is pH-dependent mechanism. One is acidic media, is called Tafel-Volmer step. And basically, in basic media, is basically happening Tafel-Volmer, Tafel-Hereski. Also, in acidic media, Tafel-Volmer, Tafel-Hereski occur. Problem with basic media is its lack of hydrogen ion concentration. So producing hydrogen out of lack of hydrogen ion concentration is really challenging. So typically people prefer acidic media. Let's configure this out. So what are the typical parameters? What do you mean by Gibbs free energy? Can anybody give us an idea? So what do you mean by the Gibbs free energy? So do you have any idea what is Gibbs free energy? Hello.
We need to apply heat as well as the pressure and the volume so we can get the Gibbs energy, sir.
But you have any idea what is Gibbs free energy? Why Gibbs free energy is so important in any kind of chemistry or thermodynamic perspective? So let's fast. So Gibbs free energy is change of energy when there is a different state change of materials or any kind of catalysis occurs. So basically they change their Gibbs free energy. If change of Gibbs free energy is very, very near to zero, that means to reacting that reaction need almost no additional energy. If the change is too large, delta G, then you need to apply some sort of energy in form of either heat or electric field. Now, the first concern is those parameters is called hydrogen ADS star, means hydrogen adsorbed hydrogen. So molecular hydrogen first come onto a surface of a catalyst. They basically transform into molecular hydrogen to hydrogen ion. And then it's transformed that changes occur in between. So this hydrogen, change in hydrogen absorbs basically followed by this Gibbs free energy parameter. So if the Gibbs free energy is too high, then hydrogen adsorption and a surface desorption need high energy. So typically number four, if you see platinum and platinum group of metals, means most those are noble metals, are demonstrate delta GH star is zero, which is high exchange current density. That means they basically catalyze the hydrogen adsorption desorption on a surface without having almost no energy. That's why their catalytic performance to HR is very high. So these are the platinum group of material like platinum, iridium, osmanium, ruthenium, rhodium, palladium, etc. Question is, with these, can we run a bus? The answer is no. We cannot run a bus using this kind of platinum type of material. So what are these conditions basically, and how does these conditions occur for Gibbs free energy? So question is, first, if the Walmart step is relatively very easy, if delta GH star is very, very small, less than zero, then your Walmart step is very easy, like adsorption is very easy. But that hydrogen gonna be adsorbed so strongly with the surface. So the Staffel or Hirsky step, like followed by Walmart, there's a Staffel or Hirsky step, which eventually poisoning the catalyst surface, means the hydrogen being absorbed, never dissolved. So hydrogen evolution is not possible. So these difficult hydrogen desorption state. So therefore, another condition two says, if delta GH star is too high, in that case, your binding energy to the catalyst surface is too weak. The hydrogen molecule may not be absorbed on the surface. So that's why this start Walmart step energy is more to absorb. And that's what it's limit overall catalytic performance. That's what delta G star need to be very optimized. So if we look at the new kind of materials to search, so people, platinum is one of the most known. Now, if you line it up, you see platinum is very close to zero. So platinum is one of the ideal materials. Platinum 111, even close to zero, single crystal platinum. So that still need 111 need adsorption desorption. Now you see the nickel molybdenum coming just next to it. Also, molysulfide is bringing next to it. So in a delta G star, what is our strategy to develop it? So that's what we do, the different type of phase engineering of MOS2. Hybrid structure formation, heterostructure, activating Bessel plane, functionalization, different kind of defect energy. So with this, we basically start with nickel moly-based different kind of oxides, different kind of alloys, and different kind of structure. On those kind of structure, like nickel moly oxide, we basically generate 2D MOS2. So in 2D MOS2 coated with nickel moly surface, basically they form a typical 1D 2D heterostructure. And that paper is published in ACS Applied Nanomaterials. So when you see this concept, different kind of forest-like structure is forming on top of MONI4 MO. So these things typically shows us that, so if it is a standard platinum results, our data is basically here. So we are very close to the platinum. So if platinum is 34 millivolt per decade in a Tafel slope, basically Tafel slope here is 67 millivolt, is just a few millivolt way. But what is the benefit? The material is very low cost, and there has been that's large scale scalable devices is possible. Also, different kind of formation says different kind of stability test, and we saw that clear distinction between an impedance, which typically shows the charge transfer resistance is very, very high. How charge transfer resistance increases? Because if charge transfer resistance increases only because of the high surface area and edge-plane-like of structure that we demonstrated here. So you see the edge-type of structure here. This edge-type of structure typically shows a different kind of charge transfer at the interface. And that's what those kind of structures shows, unique properties. So different kind of summary that we can form, like emerging nanomaterials have a nano-architecture, they have highly effective for various applications, including broadband absorption, electronic energy devices, 2D material are promising with high in-plane conductivity, high electrochemical activity is not up to the mark. Functionalized 2D material exhibit various kind of electrocatalytic activities, but also they need to be optimized properly. Different kind of heterostructure formation need to be developed to check permutation combination. Also, 2D MOS2 could be ideal replacement of graphene for electronic optical quantum devices. Various MOS2 structure also produces different light induced carrier injection at the interface. So that's what can be used as a light detector. At this point, what is the typical challenge? So basically, perspective and challenge, you can see controllability of those kind of primary materials are very, very challenging, specifically 2D materials. Now, along with this, if we have the nanoscale, new architecture generally induced a new functionality in the nanoscale materials, and that nanoscale materials can produce a different type of structures. Engineering of 2D material also producing nanoscale, nanoarchitecture, archetype, enormous, they produce enormous possibilities of electrocatalysis, photoelectrocatalysis, and different type of applications. However, their kinetics and plasmon-induced catalytic activity is a little low. That's what we need to study it, the HR kinetic and faster kinetics. So in 1959, in his Nobel lecture, Professor Richard P. Feynman told a simple word, there is a plenty of room at the bottom. That means in atomic scale, you have a lot of room in the bottom. Now, after 64 years, we realize these type 1, type 2, type 3 are different type of heterostructure is possible. You see the permutation combination in this curve. You see the left hand is a different material, right hand different material. So a person's single lifetime even less to understand each and every material. So that means there is plenty of room. So you can start developing. So you have to be smart enough and that's it. So these are the typical knowledge base that we have, like we have a book we edited. So I'll suggest you to definitely go through this book based on heterostructured materials. We have a lot of journal publication in my website has been given. And I'm really thankful to IIT Beach who always support my research, as well as Ministry of Education, Ministry of Human Resource and Development, ACRB, DST, UGC.
This is questionnaire session. Participants can give your queries and feedback to our chief guest.
Good afternoon, Professor. very good presentation. So I have few doubt regarding preparation of 2D nanomaterials. My voice is audible, sir?
It's audible, sir.
Suppose here sir explained a 2D structure of molybdenum sulfide. Suppose I want to prepare a 2D structure of molybdenum sulfide at room temperature or microwave condition. So what are the possible parameter need to be optimized for to obtain 2D structure of molybdenum sulfide or other semiconducting material? Please kindly suggestion, sir.
Okay, so thank you so much. So this is a really, really good question. So first of all, you need to understand the mechanism of molysulfide formation. Okay. So typically molybdenum react with sulfur and then form molysulfide either or in a reducing atmosphere. Molyoxide is basically transformed into molysulfide. And that we both of these two need some energy to form. Means they are not exothermic reaction. They typically need some energy. And that's what the room temperature formation are typically highly challenging. Okay. So in case of hydrothermal method, you can do it at around 200 degrees centigrade. Like several people worked with work with 170 to 190 degrees centigrade. But this hydrothermal method also consists of a very huge pressure generation inside the autoclave bomb. So that is simply means this high energy requirement, basically a formation of the structure involving that materials, typically aligning with their formation, crystalline formation. So room temperature, I don't know if anybody produces this till date, but room temperature is kind of very difficult. Like a slight high temperature is required. Okay. Did I answer your question properly?
Yes, sir. So my question is, after preparing hydrothermal, so without keeping vacuum conditions, because sulfide it easily will convert to oxidize. So I need to preserve, does not involve with oxygen. So after hydrothermal treatment, under drying process, is possible to do it some molybdenum sulfide or tungsten sulfide or other type of sulfide?
You can do that.
Yes, sir.
Under hydrothermal condition, within 160 to 190, now question is, if you really want to make, you can go through all of our papers. It's clearly written what are the parameters. You can try out. Now, sometimes what happened, we can do it here, maybe 180 degrees centigrade. In your case, maybe that is 175 or 185, like 5 degree plus minus you have to optimize in order to get very good structure and result, you know. So, I will suggest you to optimize it with after looking at our paper, okay, and you can easily synthesize it, no issue.
Thank you, sir. So one more another two questions, sir. Pardon me, understanding I'm asking to you. So in SID pattern, selected area electron diffraction, so most of the paper giving planes respect to circles, how many circles is there, respect to planes are mentioning. So how they're identifying respective circles with the plane 100001, like that they are mentioning. So for my understanding, my asking, so which circle we need to be identify 100 plane, so how they're identifying
so they are true. Identifying, sir, they are identifying on basis of, just hold on, I'm sharing my slide one more time. So then they are basically in a form of now, can you see this? Yes, sir. So here in SAD pattern, see these, there is different circle. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now in this circle, the, you see some of the circle are basically NZF, nickel zinc ferrite. Some of the circle is Gu. Okay. So now you see this is basically, this circle is basically formation at reciprocal space. You understand reciprocal space?
Yes, sir.
So that,
yes,
so that reciprocal space is formation. So now you see that's a 10 by 1 by nanometer. Now you check this, you fix the scale bar up to a certain point, okay, 10. Or this 10, you fix it. And then you start measuring this circle after fixing scale bar. Now whatever the data you get will be the equivalent of nickel zinc ferrite or graphite graphene de-spacing, means 110 de-spacing. This basically the circles suggesting the de-spacing of the material. Okay, but like, do you understand? Or else, sir, actually ask K.S.R. to develop a program for lecturing on characterization technique. So what I teach in my class, I can teach that, like how to characterize SAD, how to characterize TM, how to characterize XRD. So those things I teach here in my class. So I can teach them that too. So how to do this, that's definitely need some sort of knowledge. Okay. But what does this mean? I basically explain it. Okay.
Thank you, sir. In my last question. So in TEM analysis, transmission electron microscopy, so how we can be able to differentiate a graphite admixture with the molybdenum sulfide, or graphene oxide admixed with the molybdenum oxide, or reduced graphene oxide. So how we confirmed this material?
Okay, so I am going to show you one screen one more time. You see, can you see my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now look at this very carefully. This is basically TM result. This is TM result. These all are TM result. This 1, 2, 3, 4. Now you have one SAD result, one HRTM result. How do you know it is HRTM results? You look at all the scale bar, 100, 100, 200, 100, these all are TM. The moment HR goes is below 20 nanometers. So 20 nanometer is always in TM, HRTM. And this is reciprocal space is always basically considered as a SAD pattern. Now, if you look at it very carefully, all these data, like for example, here we are presenting nickel zinc ferrite and graphene. So this graphene, which is basically layered structure, and nickel zinc ferrite basically connected to graphene, is clearly shown using this structure. You see here, this is the graphene region, and this particular region is the nickel zinc ferrite. Similarly, nickel zinc ferrite particles are connected this way. And the background, there is a flake type of structure is basically graphene. So that's what the experience matters. So mostly you need some experience to look into those kind of data. Specifically heterostructure seeing, you need some experience. For me, I already seen pure graphene and already seen pure nickel zinc ferrite. Now when I mix it together, I can easily identify that this region is graphene, this region is nickel zinc ferrite. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
That
yes, sir. Understand.
Needs some sort of knowledge, and that's what is really very interesting. So, if you can organize some sort of characterization course or so, we can definitely discuss. Okay. So, please go ahead if you have any question.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you so much. I appreciate. So is there any more
question? Sir, you told about coal circle.
Coal-coal semicircle formation, that's true.
So what is the use of that circle here?
So that Kolekole circle basically disperses the radio wave frequency. So you know, if the Kolekole circle is kind of, it's kind of very, very unique concept. So imagine you have a graphite. Now you imagine one carbon atom is missing there. Then what happened? Is a defect formation. Now, if the defect formation occurs, then what could happen there? Tell me. So one carbon atom missing means it basically missing while leaving 3-4 electrons in the structure. Agree? So that defective place have different electron concentrations. So that electron concentration typically produces different type of Kolekole semicircle in different portions. While if there is a radio frequency come at the interface, basically it disperses that Kolekole circle. So that is the role for dispersing the radio wave frequency. And that is the significance of Kolekole semicircle there. Okay.
So that defect is necessary, sir, for getting such type of property.
Yeah, that's a very good question. So thing is that there is a lot of different parameters are also there. For example, now if you add some different material, so those materials can also form a Kolekole circle. Here we studied graphene and we realized that Kolekole circle play important role in dispersing the radar absorbing material, and that's what we are offering that structure. Basically we are saying that this kind of things happening here. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes sir, but my question, what is the main player behind that? Is that graphene or that missing atom?
Yeah, so typically graphene is very conducting, you know. So when graphene is very conducting, they basically producing the what they do basically, they basically reflect back the wave frequency. Here typically it is a reduced graphene oxide, which is actually not graphene. So when you are fabricating this with the material, radar, any radar frequency even come at this point, we found that definitely this graphene play an important role of reflecting back, while Kolekole semicircle basically dispersing the structure. Typically defects play the typical role here, not graphene. That's a very good, very good, insightful question, actually.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
So nice of you. Thank you so much. Any more question?
Sir, one more question. Can we get same feature in any material by creating defects? Means
so
conducting material.
Now, is there any material after creating defect they can become conducting or something forming Kolekole? Because graphite has unique structure, you know, right? It's an sp2 bonded carbon, and that carbon do have different kind of atomic dispersion or so. So that's what, to me, it is maybe possible, but that we need to study. Like, we have not studied it anymore after certain funding crunch, because no funding are there on that field. So we slow down that study. So we're supposed to study it a little more detail. In that case, it will be interesting.
Thank you.
Most welcome. So
any other questions?
See, if there is no other question, I think
photo session. Fill the All the participants are requested to turn on your camera for a while to take photos.
Ma'am, photo session varvingla.
Thank you. I call upon Mrs. D. Bhuvaneshwari, Assistant Professor, Department of Mathematics, to present vote of thanks.
Gratitude unlocks the fullness of life. It turns what we have into enough and more. It's my privilege and honor to extend a vote of thanks on this memorable occasion. First and foremost, I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to our special guest, respected Dr. Santanu Das. We are deeply grateful for the insightful presentation on atomic scale hybrid nanostructures, a new archetype of electronics and energy devices. Your expertise has broadened our understanding of this cutting-edge technology. Thank you for sharing your knowledge with us. Thank you, sir. A special thanks to our principal, vice principal, and directors of the academy in absence here. And I would like to thank HODs and faculty members for this grateful session. I would also like to extend my thanks to our organizing committee who have worked to make a session a grand success. Thank you, participants, for your cooperation on today's session. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. So can I leave right now?
Thank you, brother. Thank you very much. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. That's okay.